And hello, friends. Good to be with you. Before we dive into the discussion, feeding Homo sapiens, what we know and how we know it. First of all, if you paid attention to that video, I'm pleased to report I have managed to get a haircut. So the last time I attended this conference, I guess it was early in the pandemic when all that was very difficult. But things did improve on that front. And actually, just a quick anecdote from the last time I attended in person, and it's worth starting there because, of course, this is lovely. Nice to have this opportunity to address you. But it's better to be in the same place at the same time. So we all look forward to getting that normal back. But the last time we had it, I was looking for something to eat at the hotel that was playing host to this conference just before my talk. And the best option was a quinoa salad in the lobby restaurant. So I ordered that. And it wasn't bad, really. But interestingly, the server asked me, inevitably, do you want protein with that? And of course, protein meant, you know, chicken or fish or shrimp, the usual suspects. And I trust most of you know quinoa is an excellent protein source. And I start with that anecdote just to say how insidious the distortions about diet and health are. We talk all the time in our culture about protein, and it's basically a tag to mean meat or animal foods. And that entire dialogue is oblivious to the fact that you can be a vegan and have more than adequate protein intake, both in quantity and quality. But again, it infiltrates our culture. And so almost everywhere you go, no matter what you're doing, the distortion is there to greet you and to lead you astray. So we should not underestimate the magnitude of the challenge we face. We are working, and I do mean we, because the real privilege in being a speaker in front of an audience is to influence. And then with that influence, to have the message paid forward again and again and again, and you know, through 6 degrees of separation, we can get Kevin Bacon in on it. But that's really the point. It's not just conversation. It is, per the disclaimer, not about providing individual medical care. It's about important messages that collectively can translate into a revolution. We need a cultural revolution in terms of how we think about food, the role it plays. And that needs to reverberate through the very lexicon, how we talk about it. You know, again, every server in every chain restaurant in this country, however many millions of encounters that may represent every day, is asking that kind of question. Would you like protein with that? It already has quinoa, that doesn't count. It already has chickpeas, that doesn't count. Protein means meat, protein is good, therefore meat is good. We have our work cut out for us. We have miles to go before we sleep. What we don't lack, though, is robust knowledge about the optimal care and feeding of Homo sapiens, and in particular, the optimal care and feeding of our kind of animal in a world that remains hospitable to every other kind of animal. The preservation of the beautiful places in nature, of biodiversity, this planet's greatest treasure. So let's talk about what we know and how we know it. We'll begin with what diet can do, our fundamental knowledge of the power, if you will, of diet. And of course, I'm well aware of the lineup of speakers into which I am configured here today. So some of these messages will be rather concordant with what you've heard, or perhaps are going to hear over the course of this conference. I think that's fine. You know, I think as you sift through all of this to decide what matters most, what's most actionable, what's most reliable, where do you want to plant your feet knowing that the ground won't shift beneath you, it's likely to be those areas of confluence. I'll come to this before my talk is done, but I founded a nonprofit organization, the True Health Initiative, that was mentioned in the intro, and that exists to amplify and broadcast the science, the sense, and the global expert consensus about the fundamentals of healthy, sustainable eating and living. That third point, expert consensus, is really important, because if a lot of smart, well-educated people are examining the same space, absolutely there can be differences of opinion about details, but we ought to agree about the fundamentals. So as you listen to all these talks, think about, you know, what was repeated? What are the themes that, you know, are incontrovertible, because all the experts were saying that. And they may have differed about some particular food or some particular source of oil, or, you know, some preferred higher fat versus lower fat, but those are details. What are the fundamental details? So that's what I want to talk about. And it begins really with, as I say, the power of diet. So I finished my training in internal medicine in 1991, went on to Yale to do my preventive medicine training. And I completed my training in preventive medicine, public health in 1993. So just shy of 30 years ago. And that year, just within a couple months of my graduation, this paper came out. And I always talk about this paper because it changed the course of my career, quite frankly. Actual causes of death in the United States. That's a pretty provocative title. What Mike McGuinness and Bill Foege did in this paper was look beyond causes of death listed on death certificates and said, look, you know, if somebody dies of a heart attack or heart failure secondary to a heart attack, and the cause of death is listed as atherosclerotic heart disease, we haven't learned anything. We already knew they had heart disease because they died of a heart attack. So you basically said the thing that they died of is the cause of death. But what we really want to know is what caused that? What caused the atherosclerosis? What's something fixable in this picture? So McGuinness and Foege answered that question, looking past the superficiality of the immediate cause of death. They basically said everything listed on a death certificate is an effect, not a cause. We want to know the causes of those effects, which are in turn the causes of death. And they answered that question. And I definitely commend to those of you who look at peer-reviewed papers, this one, if you haven't read it already. They enumerated a list of 10 factors which collectively account for all of the premature deaths in our country every year, but for a rounding error. What captivated my imagination and altered the trajectory of my career was the fact that just the first three things on this list of 10, just by themselves, accounted for 80% of the premature deaths every year, and also 80% of the burden of chronic disease. Those three things were tobacco, poor diet, lack of physical activity. And as some of you may have heard me say before, I've always referred to these ever since as bad use of feet, forks, and fingers. Those are the master levers of medical destiny. 80% of the premature deaths that occur in our country every year are bundled right there. When this was revisited 10 years later, it was still true. So a secondary analysis by, among others, the director of the CDC at the time, Julie Gerberding, reaffirmed that, in fact, almost all of the premature deaths in our country every year were preventable by means at our disposal, not just now in 2021, but way back then in 1993 and 2000. And tobacco, poor diet, lack of physical activity were still by far and away the leading causes. And 10 years after the initial analysis, the gap between tobacco as number one and bad use of feet and forks as number two had narrowed, mostly because we were smoking less, and thank goodness for that, but also because we were exercising less and eating just as badly, if not worse. So not all the news was good. So this was the lay of the land. This, if you will, was the epidemiologic landscape into which my career was launched. And I, what it did to me and my career was induce me to say, look, I want to be a physician, take care of patients. I know that. But I also intend to be a clinical researcher. And when I first started thinking about that, I thought the way all researchers think. I want to ask the next, as yet unasked, really interesting, important question, and then try to generate a meaningful answer. But when I looked at this, I said, we already have the answers. We're just not doing anything with them. We already know how to prevent 80% of premature deaths and 80% of the burden of chronic disease. And, you know, to appreciate the full magnitude of that, you know, just stop and think about your own personal network, people you love, your friends and family, and think about every case of cancer or diabetes or heart attack or heart failure or stroke or dementia. I mean, all the bad stuff that plagues us in modern epidemiology. And now imagine, and you could think even further about the day you got the news. And I mean, we've all lived through this many, many times. Imagine if 8 times in 10, that never happened. 8 out of 10 of those people never got any of that stuff. That's what 80% less chronic disease and premature death would feel like in the world. It would touch us all. Things that have invaded our lives and our families wouldn't 80% of the time. It's really quite astounding. So I looked at this literature and said, if we already know how to prevent 80% of premature death and chronic disease, and we're not doing much of anything with it, I'm going to have to let somebody else ask the questions about the residual 20%. I'm going to have to devote my career and every ounce of my strength to turning what we already know into what we routinely do. We say knowledge is power, but our lack of use of what we know belies that. Knowledge is only power if you translate what you know into routine action. And these 30 years, we've not been doing that. So that became the basis for my career, my clinical work, my writing, my teaching, my journalism, and the research that I did at Yale.